Hey YouTube, welcome back to another episode of Yu-Gi-Oh! Wilderness. This time, it's a little more arid than the previous locations. Welcome to the Sonoran Desert. So, for today's episode, we're gonna be hiking through the sun and through the cactus and see what kind of Yu-Gi-Oh! Wildlife can make it out here in the desert. So, make sure you got a water bottle ready and some sunscreen because it's gonna be a hot one. Let's go. Under the desert sun, it takes quite a tough card to be out here. Quite a hardy card. Let's keep moving on. Oh man, so during the hottest part of the day in the desert, a lot of times you'll notice that a lot of the Yugi monsters that we're looking out for today, they're actually taking shelter in the shade. So anywhere they can find a rock, a branch, a cave in the mountainside, anywhere where they can get a little bit of shade, that little bit of shade makes a huge difference in them either being sun bleached or not. Because you can clearly tell when a card has been out in the sun too long and sun bleached. So all we gotta do is just look under the rock and we'll find something. All right, so not surprised that we found a venom snake out here. They're quite common, although you have to be really careful when looking around for them because those venom counters that they can distribute are pretty dangerous and they can weaken you bit by bit. So whenever you find one, you have to always be very cautious when handling it. And just to play it safe, we're gonna put him back underneath this rock before he gets a little testy with us. So we caught a pinch hopper. Not too surprised. This may be a desert, but there's so much vegetation around here that it's not surprising that we were able to catch one of these guys out here. So a lot of the times, these little guys like to hop around, and often you'll find them in swarms. And you'll notice that usually when this card is leaving an area, you can be pretty sure that other insects are gonna follow them in suit. So be wary, when you find one, there's gonna be a lot more out there. But this guy isn't bothering anyone at the moment, so we're gonna go ahead and put him back in the bush. Okay, another thing to know when you're out here, always watch your step. Because one misstep and you may just bother the wrong desert resident, and the 2,500 attack bite, that can be pretty painful sometimes. So be sure to watch your step out here. And I'm not gonna bother you, so please don't bite me. Or sting, Oh man. So much cool stuff out here. Let's keep moving. This is it. This is the card that we have been looking for all day today, and I'm happy we were able to find one. If you can take a look, you can see a Puralis, the purple pyro tile. So, this is one of the most iconic reptile type monsters that you can find out here in the desert. And wow, we are lucky to find one today. So, gotta be very careful when handling him. I'm gonna try to bring him up. So, this tiny little reptile type monster can be very, very dangerous. There's a reason why I'm trying to handle this one with care. So, you can notice he's a fire type monster. And that kind of makes sense. If you feel around us, all the heat and stuff, the sunlight, right now with the cloud cover, he's a little more active. And normally you'll see during the morning time when the sun's out, he'll come out. And then later in the evening when it starts to cool down, he'll come out to be active. But during the heat of the sunlight, during, you know, around noon to 3 o'clock, he'll probably be under a rock. But since it's cloudy right now and with a little bit of breeze, he's actually out cruising around the desert. And we were lucky enough to find him. Wow. So his venom is actually quite interesting. So when he actually distributes his bite, the opponent monster that it actually ends up biting will lose 500 attack permanently. So the venom that it uses is does permanent damage, which is really unique for Yu-Gi-Oh monsters. Often it's the temporary, you'll often see poison axe temporarily before it wears off, but this is a permanent loss. So it's very potent and interesting that the venom that this little guy is packing. And I'm just really happy we were able to find him. So with respect, because I don't want to get bitten myself, I'm going to go ahead and put him back exactly where I found him. Wow, what a day in the desert. Wow, gotta love this scenery. So, that's going to do it for today's episode of Yu-Gi-Oh! Wilderness, but before we go, you guys know the drill, I'm not leaving you out of here without some real-life Yu-Gi-Oh! Wilderness knowledge, because what's the fun if you didn't learn anything, right? Now, today, if you guys remember the Pyrotile that we caught earlier, we're basing that in real life off of the Gila monster, which is a native that you can find out here in the Sonoran Desert. The Gila monster is one of two venomous lizard species that you can find here in the desert southwest of the United States. So, let's talk about that venom. We alluded to it briefly when we were talking about Pyrotile and, you know, just how its attack reduction, but as I said earlier, it is a venomous species of lizard. And what it does actually, it does not have fangs like you would think of a cobra or a pit viper of any sort, but it actually just distributes its venom just by chewing, really. It will actually secrete with its saliva from the lower jaw, and it will bite down on its prey and distribute its venom. So normally, to a fully grown adult human, it's not fatal, and you can probably survive it. Obviously, you'll need it treated, but you'll be fine, but it is excruciating to experience. Its venom causes internal hemorrhaging of organs, and it can be quite painful. Interestingly enough, because I mentioned that they don't have fangs and they secrete with their lower jaw and their saliva, oftentimes when you see a Gila monster trying to distribute its venom to its prey, it will go over on its side and bite upside down so that its lower jaw is actually on the top. So that way it's easier for its venom to be injected into the prey item that it has whilst it's chewing into the prey and distributing that venom. So it's really quite cool. So, as for their status right now, here in the desert southwest, Gila monsters are listed as potentially threatened. They're not on the watch list. And what's the biggest threat that could potentially threaten them as a population? All this land behind me, and all across the desert southwest. Take a guess. You're looking at one right now in the camera, and I'm looking at one of you guys sitting behind the screen. People. Surprise, surprise. So oftentimes you'll notice that development of lands like this can play a huge toll on species, not just Gila monsters, because obviously as a predator you need prey items, but so many species rely on this desert habitat. And this being one of the most diverse deserts in North America and on the planet, it hosts a wide variety of animals and plants to that matter as well. In fact, the large cactuses you see around me, the saguaro cactuses, are only native to the Sonoran Desert and can't be found anywhere else in the world. So oftentimes, what these lands are used for, if they're not flat and developed for housing or any kind of road development, what you'll notice is it's actually turned into rangeland. And you may think, raining car games, if a cow's maybe just walking over it once every month or so, what's the damage? Actually quite a lot. So if you think about it, when grazing animals, when livestock comes through a certain area, they will strip every single bit of edible plant life down to the ground. And so what you would have a few patches of grass or available food resources for, let's say, a desert tortoise, if those are all eaten up, there's nothing left for the native species in that area. And you'll notice where oftentimes out west here, a lot of this is rangeland used for cattle ranching and other livestock ranching. A lot of times you'll notice wildlife populations are lower just because there's less resources. They're competing with livestock out here just to survive. So it can be quite tough. You'd think an animal that can survive in the desert can survive through tough conditions, but if there's no food, it's kind of tough. And then also water is a critical resource. So oftentimes water out here is a precious resource and it's very, very scarce. And wherever you can find it, you need to keep it safe. So oftentimes people out here will dam rivers to make reservoirs. And in some cases, a lot of water that could have gone out to certain areas in the desert to provide life-giving substance is used for other purposes. Some cases it's to give people water, other cases it's just to water a golf course. But water is another critical resource, and when you take water away from one spot, life can't thrive there. So water, food, a lot of land management is really important in monitoring species that survive out here in the desert, because already they're living life on the edge. Because I'm pretty sure most of you couldn't live baking under the sun for your entire life without a little bit of AC. So for them to be able to do that, they need to make sure they're managing themselves and the resources around them to the pinpoint. Whew. Man, but you gotta love it out here. It is gorgeous, and the species that inhabit this desert are amazing. And if you are interested in some desert species conservation or just general information on the Sonoran Desert, I have some links down below that you guys can feel free to check out. And as always, please like, subscribe, comment down below, and if you're interested, follow me on Instagram and check out my Patreon page. But yeah, I'm just glad I was able to come out here to the desert and share this episode with you guys. But as for me, I think I'm going to go and explore some more, because this place is massive and I want to cover as much ground as possible. So, I'm out of here. You guys have a great day.